Welcome everyone to the Frinks Movement podcast. Today my guest is a very interesting persona in bodyweight training world who happens to be from the same country, Jakub Kowalski. Apart from calisthenics, Jakub is one of rare individuals having experience in a huge variety of areas, from flexibility through tweaking and free running to pulling off some impressive squat and deadlift numbers. He's very critical and always on top of his game with training related information, which makes him a great source of knowledge for any calisthenics athlete. We discussed many exciting topics and I highly recommend to watch or listen to the whole thing, but as always I provide you with timestamps so you can choose the most interesting and applicable part for you. Enjoy! Hello and welcome everyone to the fourth podcast on this channel. Today our guest is Jakub Kowalski. Thank you Jakub for being so nice to be on the podcast today. And yeah, how are you, man?
Thanks. Thanks for having me. I'm good. I had a good training session today and watched a movie with Jackie Chan. So it's all good, man.
So we actually, that's our second podcast because we did one on Jakub channel. You can find it. So the link is in the description of this podcast. So before we jump into the main thing, which is going to be the calisthenics, combining calisthenics with other sports, losing weight for calisthenics, all this stuff is coming up very soon. But before, we would like to introduce Jakub, because I think he's one of the most interesting people in this community, as far as I'm aware and I personally know. Jakub specializes in calisthenics, but does a lot of different stuff, which you're gonna not only see, but also would like to hear something. So tell us, Jakub, a bit about yourself, because before we can start talking about some other stuff.
Okay, so I will try to be brief. I started when I was a kid with just climbing trees, trying some flips, trying handstands, stuff like that. I was just very active. And after that, I discovered parkour through some movies and documentaries in the TV. So I started doing that, just trying different moves, different tricks. And with that came the idea that I need to get stronger to be better. So I started some basic calisthenics when I was like 12. Just some push-ups, sit-ups, basic stuff because I didn't know any better. So, yeah. But of course it was good. I made progress. And after that, I discovered free running and tricking. So I wanted to do some flips, some tricks also, because when I was a kid, before parkour, I was trying some front flips, I think, in my house. So it was natural progression to go into free running, to tricking, to try this stuff. And along with that, I was still doing calisthenics, so it was mostly tricking, parkour, calisthenics for a few years. I also started stretching because I thought that it will help me with my tricking and maybe with calisthenics. And after some time, I just started to focus more on calisthenics, and I started also lifting some weights, and I did less and less parkour and flips, and now I'm just doing mostly calisthenics, weight training, a little bit of flexibility, and not as much tricking anymore, but I can still do some stuff.
Yeah, so that was just a brief representation of a wide range of skills and just different types of practice that you went through, and so I actually have this question like later on in the plan of the podcast. However, I think I would like to ask you now, what is the because you went through a lot, like through a lot of different disciplines, lot of different types of training, and there's definitely been a period where when you combined calisthenics with all these other disciplines, right? My question is, if a person wants to be, you know, complete, or he wants to try many different things, would you advise something for these people if they want to combine bodyweight training, which is seemingly very similar somehow, you know, to parkour, to acrobatics? Would you give some advice to these people who want to try and do everything at once?
Yeah, so first of all, you have to accept that the more thing you do at once, the worse you're gonna be at each thing. So because you have only so much training resources to spend, so much recovery. So the best way would be to focus on one thing for a few months, then on the other thing and the other thing. Because once you develop certain skills or strength, it's pretty easy to maintain most of the time. But of course, you can do a few things at once. But probably it's
harder.
Yeah, it's harder, but it's best to try to combine things that do not affect each other that much. That goes well together.
Yeah, so my question is exactly that. Would you say that certain disciplines, for example, we have, you know, apart from bodyweight training, okay, apart from like gymnastics, upper body skills, let's say someone wants to do flexibility, like hard flexibility training, splits, all things this nature. He wants to do tricking, acrobatics, or free running, things like that. And he wants to train his lower body with, you know, with heavy deadlifts, heavy squats, like on top of the calisthenics. So would you say that certain disciplines or certain areas of training correlate with each other more, or maybe interfere with each other?
Well, it's very complicated topic, but I will try to answer pretty short. So I think that for calisthenics, flexibility is important as long as you have goals that require flexibility that you don't have currently. Because there are many goals in calisthenics, many popular moves that really doesn't require much flexibility. So it's not like you have to train flexibility to be good at calisthenics. But if you have goals like Stalder press, pike press, good handstand, then of course you have to develop some flexibility. And I think you don't necessarily have to focus on flexibility mostly for some time and then on strength and calisthenics. You can do both at the same time without much interference. The best way to do it at the beginning, I think, would be just static passive stretching, because it will interfere the least with calisthenics, with strength training, because it's not that taxing on the body.
Okay, and sorry to stop you, because some of people may be not familiar with the terminology you're using. So static passive, would you like, how would you describe this type of flexibility?
You just relax into the stretch. You don't have to have your whole body weight pushing you. You can, for example, when you do a split, you can support yourself with your hands on the chair, and you just try to relax, take deep breath, and go deeper and deeper without tensing the muscles. So it's basically like holding the stretch for 30 seconds, 1 minute, or even more. And trying to relax the muscles and to not go too intense, but of course over time you have to go more intense, and maybe you even need to add some weight.
Okay,
to
get you.
Push you a little bit deeper.
Okay, thank you. So combining stretching, especially this type of stretching with calisthenics should not interfere that much. So they should not interfere that much with each other. What about weight training, like lower body training with, you know, squats, deadlifts, especially, you know, deadlifts seem to be like a full body exercise that is very taxing for your like pulling muscles, other pulling muscles that can be used in pull-ups, rows, you know, in front lever work. So what is your like attitude towards this thing?
We have to start with the fact that if you want to be the best at calisthenics, it will be the best to not train legs at all, right? But if you want to combine those things, then, well, there's many ways to do it, really. You could skew your training in a way that it would be more towards strength training, not really that much for hypertrophy when it comes to lower body, and then it will interfere less with upper body calisthenics. But yeah, of course, there's only so so long that you can train this way, and there will come a point where you will have to do some higher reps, some higher volume, because you just can't do strength training, low reps, high intensity for legs forever, right? Mm-hmm. So that's one thing to keep in mind. And with a deadlift, I think deadlift will interfere much more with calisthenics because of the back involvement.
Yeah.
So because it's one of the most fatiguing exercises there is, right? So I think squats will go better with calisthenics than deadlifts probably, but it can be done, but you have to accept the fact that those things will interfere with each other a little bit, or maybe a lot, depending on how you program this. So
okay,
and,
gotcha.
And over time, your legs will get bigger, and you will have problems.
Yeah. With so moves, right? Yeah. So like I mentioned, there are like in my video, there are three components that make, you know, leg training not the best thing for calisthenics. One of them is of course the recovery component.
Yeah.
So the more you do, the more you do stuff like aside from calisthenics, no matter how good your recovery is, it's still gonna, you know, add up to this recovery that you could spend on doing more of your thing that you want to get better, like your primary thing, which in our case would be calisthenics. Second is obviously like weight, you know, and leverages, which is especially important with like parallel skills like planche and front lever. Yeah, so we have flexibility and weight training, and now I would like to ask you, what about, for example, low intensity activity like running, or like, you know, someone wants to, we're gonna go like to this topic very soon, but if someone wants to lose weight, you know, and he wants to, for example, do cardio, do you think that this sort of activity is very interfering with body weight training?
I think the interference effect is a little bit overblown sometimes, but of course the most important thing if you want to lose weight, it's caloric deficit, so you don't have to do cardio at all. But if you want to do cardio for health purposes or to improve your VO2 max, right, then you have to do it at least two or three times a week, and it will have to be more and more intense, right? And then we will run into a problem of systemic fatigue of recovery resources, because everything you do it taxes your body and it requires recovery, right? Even though it's something completely different than calisthenics, then it still will affect your training. So if you want to do cardio to improve your cardio, to take it seriously, then of course it's gonna interfere with your calisthenic strength training. If you do it for health purposes, like once or twice a week, low intensity, nothing crazy, then probably you will be fine. And if you do it to lose weight, then generally for strength athletes, and I assume that most people who train calisthenics are into strength and not really into hypertrophy, because that would be not the best idea to train for hypertrophy using only bodyweight exercises. It's not the best.
Not the most efficient one.
Yeah, it's pretty stupid, really. So if you are a strength athlete and you want to lose weight and you want to do cardio, then I would advise to do the least amount of cardio you need to do for weight loss, and focus mostly on the diet, because you don't need extra fatigue, and the interference effect maybe it will affect you a little bit, maybe not. I think if you don't do that much, then probably it won't, but why take a risk, right? If you don't like cardio and you don't have to do cardio to lose weight, then you can just try caloric deficit and just a lot of walking, for example. Nothing more intense than that, right?
Okay, yeah. So I actually want to, you know, ask more questions regarding losing body weight as a calisthenics athlete, but I wanted to, you know, quickly just finish this rant about these different forms of training. So I wanted to ask about tricking, because some high, like, explosive activity, you know, like tricking. I suppose, you know, also things like bar tricks, like in street workout, things like that. Obviously, these are like upper body related, gonna be different. But yeah, your stance on that very quickly, just
if you can. Well, when it comes to tricking, we have to keep in mind that most people who are good at tricking don't really do any strength training or flexibility, even though it seems logical that it would help them. That
it does, yeah.
It is not necessarily the case most of the time. So that's one thing. And if you want to combine tricking with calisthenics or any strength training, then you would have to. Depending what is your main goal, if it's tricking or it's strength training, right? If it's tricking, then you would have to do it like once or twice a week probably, and nothing really crazy, because it's tricking is very demanding on the body. You have a lot of impact, a lot of hard landings, you have to be fresh, you have to be explosive, so it really doesn't go well together. Especially if you have exercises that are really taxing on the spine with a lot of axial loading, right? When you do overhead press, deadlift, squats, bend over rows, stuff like that, it will really affect your tricking. Mm-hmm. And if your goal is mainly strength training and you want to do some tricking on the side, then probably you will be able only to do like one or two sessions a week if you are training seriously. But even once a week may be too much if you have like four or five or six training sessions. Mm-hmm. for hypertrophy or strength, and you want to do some tricking on the side. Even once a week may be too much for you, and it will just destroy you, right? So it's probably better to focus on the tricking and do some strength training to help with that. That will be probably easier to pull off than the other way around, when strength training is your main goal and you want to do some tricking.
Okay, yeah. So it's interesting because you know, you see, and mostly like people who are not very long in this whole community, you know, in this whole game, let's call it, and they see people like Simonster, for example, you know, people who combine these things, who has great tricking abilities, breakdancing abilities, and are very strong. But the truth is that those who can pull this off are mostly like very genetically gifted. That's first. And secondly, they have like a long path of their training, the long history when they could just, you know, spend more time to develop one type of skill, then a couple of years to do different things, you know, and then after many, many years, you're at this level that you can basically combine everything. But it does not mean that it's optimal or it's just good to, you know, to do it all at once. So that was interesting. So thank you so much.
Can I add something?
Yeah.
I think in Simon's case, it's that probably he only trains upper body when it comes to strength training, and when it comes to acrobatics tricking, then it's mostly lower body focus, right? So then it's easier to combine than if you were to train your whole body with weights or with calisthenics, and then do tricking on top of that. So
yeah, but he does, you know, breakdancing, which is like form of tricking for upper body, I would call. Of course, it's not exactly like this, but something, you know, it's breakdancing is very demanding for your upper body as well.
But if you treat the both things with the same priority, if you prioritize strength training and acrobatics the same, then it's gonna be easier to combine because you won't do too much of one thing. But then at the same time you will progress slower in both, right?
Yeah. I totally understand. Yeah, but that was very interesting. So thank you so much for clarifying, especially that you're like a good person to talk about it. I myself never, you know, seriously trained so many disciplines. You know, I never had experience with tricking. If any, like very beginner level where you can, you know, allow yourself to do many mistakes and not be very smart about your training programming, managing recovery, stuff like that. So I would like to, you know, right now get back to the topic of losing weight as a bodyweight athlete. And I think it's a good, good question for you, especially now, because you are at the stage right now in your training where you lose some weight and you're at your hypertrophy mesocycle, right? Or hypertrophy phase, mesocycle one. That's what I saw today on the Instagram. So could you like tell us a bit more about your plan, like for attacking the future in terms of your goals, your training goals?
Yeah. So what I'm doing now is high volume fat loss phase or block, and I just I'm just finishing the first mesocycle, and I have very general exercises now that doesn't really are that specific to my goals, because I was doing before that I was doing strength training for pretty long time, and I ran into adaptive resistance. I was just spinning my wheels. So it was time to switch to go back to high volume, and it's at the same time it's fat loss, because from what I know about periodization and integrated periodization, that it's best to change your body composition when you are in a high volume, in a hypertrophy phase. You can either cut or bulk then, because if you are in the strength block, or if you are picking, then it's best to keep your body weight stable, to be in the maintenance. So that's why I'm doing fat loss, even though I'm training hypertrophy. It seems illogical, because when you are doing hypertrophy, you want to build muscle, right? You want to be in the surplus, because that's the best way to build muscle. But when you do high volume and you are cutting, then first of all you have to do high volume, and you have to train like you want to build muscle to not lose muscle and only lose fat. That's the goal always. Of course you have to also eat enough protein, and maybe you can even build some muscle even though you are in a deficit, and even though you are not a beginner. especially if you are doing some exercises that you never done before, which is the case for me. There's been some paper lately that showed that trained individuals can actually build muscle while being in a deficit. So it's very interesting stuff. So
it
I just
is
want
because
to,
it changes, yeah. You know, it changes, like you said before, it's pretty counterintuitive, you know, for most people. The hypertrophy block, like you mentioned, is for building muscle. So we would like to, you know, support that process of hypertrophy by caloric surplus. But if we don't have to do it, then it's going to be more logical to, you know, be as stable as you suggested, as stable with your diet in the period when you need to perform, like the performance is the closest to what you have to, you know, represent. In our case, it's going to be like skills. So
the reason I'm doing this is that after this general phase that I'm in now, and after losing some weight, I want to go back to the strength training, to the calisthenics, to finally, hopefully, achieve one arm chin up and some other stuff. So that's the reason. And I also think that those general strength gains and the muscle that I will hopefully build in the right places will also help later with calisthenics.
Mm-hmm.
That's my approach.
So I wanted to ask you, for how long do you plan on doing both phases?
When it comes to high volume fat loss, I want to do two mesocycles. So I have one more, and first was 5 weeks, and the second one will be 4 or 5 weeks. We will see. It depends on my recovery. Mm-hmm. If it's gonna be productive for 5 weeks, I don't know. And after that, I will transition into strength block, and then there will be more specificity, and the main focus will be calisthenics, not like right now when I have really general exercises.
Do you think, like, for skills of more skill nature, let's say someone wants to do a handstand push-up, because that's the example I'm going to use in my future video, actually. So I wanted to ask you, for example, you do your hypertrophy block, then strength block. And do you think, as in, for example, powerlifting, they have a tapering phase, you know? And before that, you have, after the preparation and everything, they go through the period when they train like strictly lifts. In calisthenics, with skills like handstand push-up, would you say it's productive to, for example, go through general strength phase, so the second one, would you say it's productive to go for skill mesocycle, where you do more, you know, practice type of training for, let's say, 2 weeks?
Depending on how we define that, I think the peaking for calisthenics, which is not really a sport and there's no competition, is not really needed, but you can do it just for yourself to see your progress, right? To have fun and stuff like that. But really, you could just do hypertrophy, strength block, and never go below 3 or 2 reps, and never peak, and just repeat this over and over. Or you can just do some peaking to see where you're at, right? To see your max capabilities. And then it would be a good idea to do a week or two, mm-hmm, of just low volume, high intensity skills, maybe with higher frequency, maybe not. I really don't have experience with this type of stuff, because I never really did something like that. I like to just go through hypertrophy, strength block, and I never really did this type of calisthenics picking.
Picking, yeah. So I wanted to ask, because we were talking about losing weight, and obviously the topic of body fat or body composition in general is very hard to talk about, because we don't have any guidelines apart from, you know, just visual ones. But do you have certain like kilogram number that you would like to go down to in your hypertrophy phase?
Yeah, of course, it's really arbitrary because I don't really know what would be the number that will be the best when it comes to relative strength and to and for sustainability, that I can sustain this body weight for a long time. But I think that probably, like, for me, like 85-84 kilo should be a good goal, and the body weight that I can sustain for
okay longer. And how much do you weigh right now?
Right now it's like 87 and a half to 88 and something. It's mm-hmm. fluctuating.
It fluctuates, like,
yeah.
Alright, so we're gonna see. You can obviously follow Jakub's story or Jakub's journey on his Instagram, because you post your training like every day, I think. So it's interesting, you know, to just observe the whole process. So we're gonna move on to more strictly bodyweight training related to the discussion. That is gonna be the continuation of what we did on your channel in your podcast. So first of all, I wanted to ask you about specificity of training. So as we all know, specificity is should be our number one priority in any type of training, right? But what people don't seem to realize that there is something like exists, something like that exists, the over application of specificity, which is extremely important, or I think very just often being done in calisthenics, ironically. And I myself been a victim of that, and recently just, you know, had these thoughts that I might even do a video on that. So how would you describe over application of specificity on like the calisthenics skill example?
Yeah, it would be something like no shakes, no weight, only body weight, bro. So only doing body weight movements, only going high intensity, low reps, trying your maxes all the time, doing if your goal is isometric hold, doing only isometric holds, and stuff like that. I think it's pretty common in calisthenics to just go too hard, too intense, too specific all the time, and being afraid to use weights to complement your training, and being afraid to go for higher reps for some time, or being afraid to do some general exercises.
Yeah, I remember that. Like we talked before, you know, one of my examples, my own examples of specificity over application was without any sort of base, any sort of training experience, I would call it. I was doing very specific exercises, like, for example, planche leans that were measured with the tape, you know, and I could not even do push-ups with very little lean. I had zero experience with that, zero strength, but yet I was told to be, you know, to be angle specific, to try develop this very specific strength, because planche and front lever, this is straight arm strength. This is something that cannot be developed in any other way, which is in some, like, it's true to some extent, you know. Is if you want to learn Maltese cross or Victorian, you obviously have to, the more advanced you go, you have to train more specifically. But in case of, for example, tuck planche, if you want to learn tuck planche, I think it's very, very reasonable to achieve the tuck planche with minimum, zero straight arm work, but just minimum straight arm work. And I actually had many examples of people achieving that. And I'm not saying that you should do that or that you have to do it, but it's just, you don't have to blindly, you know, follow all these guidelines that the certain skill requires this angle, so you have to do only this. You have to look a bit broader. You have to build your base first, and that would be my advice.
I was also doing too much specificity, like only calisthenics, not using weights at all. But there's a point where you just can't progress anymore with just doing specific exercises, because the problem may be that you don't have enough general or raw strength, whatever you call it.
Yeah.
And you just have to develop your base more, right? So like, for example, when training for one-arm chin-up, you can just try to be really specific, like I was in the past, and just doing the variations, the negatives, assisted exercises, stuff like that. But you eventually you will pick very fast, and eventually you will just stop progressing. You will just spinning your wheels because you just don't have enough raw power. You don't have enough pulling strength, so you have to develop that with weighted chin-ups or pull-ups or any other general pulling exercises. And sometimes you also don't have enough muscle mass, right, in the right places. But I think in calisthenics, the strength is more important, the strength base, than the muscle mass. But still, in order to develop strength in the long term, you're gonna have to need to build some muscle too, right? Because you just can't go low reps, high intensity all the time, because you will run into adaptive resistance, you will destroy your joints, your connective tissue, and sometimes you have to do something else. You have to resynthesize, you have to give your joints and your structures a break, right? And change your...
Yeah, it's interesting to see the evolution of your opinion, I would say, because we had discussions of this type not many years before, but a year ago, I think. Where, you know, we're just sharing experience with each other, like always. And I've been sharing my story with one-arm pull-up at the time, and how the best progress I ever noticed was by doing strictly weighted pull-ups and nothing else. And I remember that you were very big on trying to find the exercise that is the most specific to the one-arm chin-up. And now you, what you represent is more of a powerlifting type of, you know, mindset, where you need to step by step build up to it, and where the specific, very specific exercise would be like peaking in powerlifting. So would be doing very specific lifts, like only that, you know. And you need to be specific, but the closer you get. But it only matters like a lot when you have the actual base and you can approach the skill.
Yeah, but it's not always like that. Of course, you have examples of people who just achieve some skills by being very specific. But it really depends, of course, on the genetics or your body weight, stuff like that. I think it matters more for especially for bigger guys like me and the guys with legs. Then you have to be really intelligent with your approach. It's gonna be probably a longer road to achieve those skills, because your relative strength is not that good, right? When you're heavier, when you have legs, and then you really have to think about how to do it. Another thing I wanted to touch on, forcing specificity on the exercises that should not be really specific. this is interesting stuff when people try to, for example, turn overhead press into a handstand push-up. Like they want to do overhand press
with underhand grip, or with,
for example, or with protracted scapula, yeah, without arching of the thoracic spine and stuff like that. And I don't think that's a good idea, because in my opinion, it would be better to treat this exercise as a general strength builder, as a muscle builder, not trying to change it to be very, very specific to the handstand push-up, because then you will really screw up the stimulus to fatigue ratio. You will have worse raw stimulus magnitude. I'm using terms that were coined by Mike Israel, but I think they're very good terms to use even in calisthenics. And then you maybe you will also run into some joint problems by trying to do this exercise very strange way and very inefficient way, right? And you also have to lower the weight probably a lot. So I would rather do general exercise to build general strength and muscle, and then later be specific than trying to change the good basic exercise into something that resembles calisthenics moves.
Okay, yeah, it makes a total sense, and I think that you know, I've been a victim of it myself, because I've been trying to do overhead press with not protracted shoulder blades. However, I had very close grip. I had, you know, my back was like in normal overhead press, you should have some extension, you know, and I tried to remain like neutral to not replicate, you know, arching back in the handstand push-up. And if you focus on that, then you obviously will kill some of the productivity that this exercise brings. And we should not do that, because it's tested. We know the benefits that it can provide. So we should rather use this exercise to get these benefits that we'll probably get, and then use that in a more specific work.
Yeah, it's better to take the phasic approach when you focus on some qualities for some time, then focus on other qualities, and not trying to be always very specific and change everything to be as specific to your goals later, because it's not very productive. And also the other example, which is interesting, I think, is straight arm exercises with dumbbells. Like when you're laying on the bench.
We talked about it on your podcast, I think. We discussed it, I think.
Maybe. I don't remember right now, but when you do those exercises with straight arms, straight elbows, and you try to be very specific to do them like you would do a planche, for example, like when you lay on the bench and you do those raises, those planche raises. So it seems like a good idea. And of course, I may be wrong on that, but I think it's not the best idea, because you are very limited by your straight arm strength, by your elbows, and you're not gonna really build muscle that much this way, because you really have to lower the weight to do this exercise, and it's very taxing on the joints. And maybe it will be better to do the basic exercises that build muscle in the best way, that have good stimulus to fatigue ratio, to just build the shoulders, the biceps, the triceps, and everything you need for the planche, and then to be specific with the bodyweight exercises. Because even though you think that it's specific because you are
the angle,
yeah, you have the angle, you have the straight arms, you have your scapula protracted and everything. But it's not really that specific, because it's completely different thing than doing a planche lean or a planche, because then
it's
you're
open chained. It's
Then it's, you have to, in planche, you have to stabilize your whole body with your shoulders. You have to be mindful of your body position and stuff like that. So maybe it's not the best idea, but of course I may be wrong. Maybe someone can use this exercise and have good progress with it. That's just my opinion.
Yeah, sometimes things are not, you know, black and white, especially if we go very very far and very specific into some topic. I know that people on very high level use this exercise. At the same time, it's not any, you know, it should not be any guideline of what you should do, because like we mentioned, people who are very genetically gifted, no matter what they do, they gonna get results, and changing one exercise won't do much, you know, difference for them. Yeah, but it's interesting, you know, because I heard lots of different opinions on, like, things you mentioned, you know, like Maltese with dumbbells, even front levers or Victorians with dumbbells, so the reverse version. But on one of your posts, you mentioned that was obviously from the book, but you mentioned how strength is specific, and you listed a couple of points. So these exercises with dumbbells, they have some points. For example, I heard the argument that you should use them because it's the only way to replicate the angle of the planche. But you can do the same, for example, with band assisted planche, if you can do that right, you know, with static hold with bands. Or
planche lean is usually very close to the trade angle that you will have in the planche, right?
Yeah, I think, you know, it depends, of course, it depends on how you do it.
I can add one last thing to this exercise with dumbbells, because usually people do it for high reps, right?
Yeah.
And when you do exercise for the high reps, it's then the goal is to usually to build muscle, or I don't know, probably maybe work on technique, but I think most of the times you do it to build muscle specific to the skill you want to achieve, or maybe condition your elbows or stuff like that, I don't know. So if let's assume the goal is to build muscle, and you do, because you do it for high reps, but you also want to be really specific at the same time, then I think if the goal is to build muscle, then it's better to choose the exercises that have the best stimulus to fatigue ratio, that are the best at building certain muscles, and then to be specific with the bodyweight exercise, because the specificity will be higher, and you will build more muscle, you will build them more efficient with general exercises.
So what you say here is, if you have, for example, your hypertrophy phase, instead of mixing your exercises and do a hybrid type of training where you are specific, but at the same time, you know, you try to build muscles, so you want to use exercises that you can do for, you know, high reps and stimulate the muscle, instead of doing that and finding this middle spot, do exercises that are more general, from the, like, their nature is to build muscle, and then not to lose your skill ability, or to even improve a little bit, you know, in your hypertrophy phase. You can be very specific, but add it, for example, you know, add your planche lean after your bench press, or do planche lean before, you know, you do skill work before your session, I found. Yeah, lately.
That's another topic that I can really quickly touch on, because I was really afraid of losing specificity, of going really general for some time, and I think that was unfounded, because it's not like when you go for month or 2 months or 3 months without specificity that you will just forget everything, and then you have really hard time to go back to it. It's not like that. Once you learn something, you can really go back into it pretty quickly, And I think we should not be that afraid of abandoning specificity for some time and then coming back to it, because you have to remember that everything you add to your training during your hypertrophy, during your general phase, it will affect your recovery and your progress, right? So everything has a cost, and maybe it's better to just really be general, really be focused on the hypertrophy, on the general strength, whatever you do, and then later be more specific and to use the strength and or the muscle you built. Because even though you do one set, just like I did lately, one set of some skill work, some specific stuff before your training, before your training session, it's still gonna affect it in some way. It's not gonna be much, but still, and it's probably not the best idea if you really want to be the optimal, you really want to be aligned with the science, right? So that's something.
So did you actually abandon your skill work before your sessions? Because okay, but what did you do, like muscle ups before, things like, because I remember watching you, and I thought you had some, you know, some plans, some formula for these skills, because you were doing lots of different you were displaying different skills each day. So you did like muscle ups one day, and then you did handstand push-up, things like, you did not have any plan for that. You just go when like was going for feeling, or you had some plan maybe.
The plan was to do just one set of like 1 to 2, 1 to 3 reps, and I was trying not to go to failure, to RP 10. But when I rethinked it, and I also listened to Mike Israel, I think recently, when he touched on similar topic, and I realized that doing one set of something specific, it's not really gonna maintain your technique, your skill that much, and at the same time, it will affect your training a little bit. So it's basically probably pointless. And I also realized that I don't have to be afraid of abandoning specificity for some time, because it's not like I'm gonna have hard time later remembering all the skills. It will come back really fast, and it's gonna be good. And there's something about abandoning some exercises completely for some time that provides benefits, because then you maybe when you start after a long break again, then maybe this time you will develop your technique a little bit better, because you have a somewhat of a fresh start, right? So there may be some benefits to that of just abandoning some specific exercises for longer time and then going back to them again.
Yeah, that's something that I definitely gonna, you know, take myself, because I remember that when I was planning, you know, my training, I always had this in mind, you know, not to lose gained abilities already. And I actually have some experience, you know, with losing certain skills. It's not the best thing to put into my CV, into my training CV, but I lost a lot of skills. And unfortunately, one of those abilities that very quickly, or not very quickly, but disappeared from my arsenal was repping out handstand push-ups. And I was wondering for a long time, is that because I lost because I abandoned some, you know, specificity, and I just abandoned this exercise? But I quickly came into realization that it's not the case, that I actually just got heavier and weaker. And, you know, and that's... It's not, you know, it's not like doing one handstand push-up 3 times a week would save my progress here.
Exactly.
Because if I was just, you know, lazy, and maybe not lazy, you know, but I did not put more time generally into training, and, you know, I ate worse, you know, I had, my diet was worse, I did not lose the handstand push-up because of lack of specificity and lack of skill work done twice a week, but because of these whole, you know, other things that I just mentioned. And we have to be specific, of course, but we have to remember that the hypertrophy phase is, it's not like specific to the movement, but we are still, you know, training the muscles that we are going to use in the skills. So it is, you know, it's not like we do totally different kind of training. It's not like we want to, you know, become, for example, if it's not like we do, if you train for planche and our hypertrophy phase contains of only squats. We trained, you know, we train muscles that we actually going to use later on. So it is specific in this way.
But we have to add that hypertrophy phase for a bodybuilder and for strength athlete, it's a little bit different. It's not the same thing. When you are strength athlete and you're doing hypertrophy training, then you should really focus more on progressing by adding weight, not really that much by adding reps or sets. And when you are bodybuilder, then it's probably a little bit more important to go for the higher sets and progress by reps.
Okay, so in hypertrophy phase, strength athletes. So I always thought that if your priority is strength in a given phase, then you're gonna try to, you know, increase the intensity. And if the hypertrophy is the priority in a given phase, that you should increase volume, you should increase sets. Like that would be the preferable way to improve. But there is a difference, right, in strength.
Yeah, because and if you are increasing the weight and you keep the sets and reps stable, you're still increasing the volume. You're increasing the volume load,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
But if you are a bodybuilder, then it's probably more important to go for the sets, reps. But of course, you have to increase the weight too. It's just like a little bit different priorities,
okay,
right?
Okay, yeah.
And it's gonna be explained in the hypertrophy book, Scientific Principles of Hypertrophy Training by Mike Isratel, that will come out in the 2021 probably. And I know that in this book it's gonna be explained the difference of hypertrophy phases for strength athletes and for the bodybuilders, and I can't explain it that well, but
yeah, but
someone will read it, right?
Yeah, sure. It's something, it's another thing that I'm gonna take, you know, and put, for example, into a video. So yes, so I had one more questions, you know, one more question strictly about bodyweight training, and I don't want you know, to go very in depth on this one, because that's just something that we talked, I think, on Instagram once, and that's something that I use often, and wanted to know your opinion on using the RPE or reps in reserve, basically some sort of subjective relative intensity scale in calisthenics, where we cannot you know, measure the percentages, but we can you know, measure the how hard was the set.
It's probably a good idea to use RP or reps in reserve in calisthenics, but it comes with its own problems, because for example, when you do L-sit to planche, right, and you're doing the reps, and you know that you can do another rep or two, but the question is if this next rep, is it's gonna be something that you can really count, because maybe you can do another rep, but your hips will be a little bit below your shoulders, right? And then that's the question, if you count it or not, and where is the where you draw the line, right? So that's one problem when it comes to reps in reserve in calisthenics, that you have to have some form standards.
Yeah.
But the question is if you really have to be super strict with it, right? That's one thing. And when you do higher reps, in calisthenics or generally, then going to failure when you're training high reps for hypertrophy, it's generally beneficial. Of course, you don't want to do failure training all the time, but it's beneficial for hypertrophy. But for strength training, when you go lower reps, it's probably a good idea to always leave some reps in the tank, like 1, 2, 3, maybe even 4, and then it's gonna be more useful to keep in mind how many reps in reserve you have, and to really focus on the quality and on the technique. And I think that maybe when you're doing low reps, like up to 6 reps, and you are focusing on the strength, on the quality, maybe it would be better to not necessarily knowing exactly how many reps you have in reserve, but just aiming for like 2 to 4, and to really go for quality and for not losing your focus, your body awareness, and just maybe doing more sets instead of going for more reps. Because for strength, failure training is not really that beneficial. It's definitely more beneficial when you train for hypertrophy.
Yeah, so, because that's something, you know, that I like to do, you know, because from my experience, when I say, you know, when I, for example, prescribe to do 8 reps, you know, this person is going to do everything to complete the reps.
Yeah.
And even though, you know, even though the, no matter if it's like the ego thing or this person just wants to be very strict with the program, this person does not understand that doing 7 reps but not doing that last grinder will be more beneficial from the standpoint of full training program or full training week. So that's why from couple of months I like to, you know, just add this little note. And I'm not saying, you know, RPE 9 or RPE 8.5. I just, you know, say that do these many reps, but have 1 rep in reserve, which means that the last rep is not going to be the absolute grinder. That's all I want to achieve by prescribing that. And so, yeah, I just thought that it's maybe very beneficial from the strength training standpoint.
Yeah, and we have also problems like when you do pseudo planche push-ups, and you do your reps, and you could do a few more reps if you just decrease lean a little bit, right? And then it's problematic. How many reps in reserve you really have? Do you really can keep the same amount of lean, the same technique all the time, and just knowing that you have 2 reps left with the same technique? It's really, really hard to know, right? Because in calisthenics, most exercises are very technical, requires a lot of focus, body awareness. So
that's one of the maybe not mistakes, but things I maybe would do a little bit different in one of the episodes of the calisthenics programming. I remember that I gave that example of pseudo planche push-ups, where you can set the limit of, for example, 8 reps, you know, and say to yourself that you're gonna do 8 reps with 1 rep in reserve, and you lean as much as you can, but the last rep is gonna be 1 rep in reserve. The problem is, what 1 rep in reserve? Is that gonna be a normal push-up? This set is gonna be so intense that the last rep will be just normal push-up without any lean? Will that normal push-up even be a grinder, you know? Or this rep is gonna be just like the other ones? So that's the problem, because you have another, you know, variable in the whole. You can change the technique as the exercise goes.
And it's not only the lean, because you can also lose your protraction, and where do you draw the line? How much protraction you accept, and when it's too little, right?
Yeah, that's why I decided not to change the form that's, you know, that's both psychological and, you know, just technical for me to, you know, make programming easier. I just decided not to either do or neither do nor prescribe for people sets where the intensity changes, where they do, for example, one lean to LC to straddle planche, then advanced tuck, then tuck, because apart from the stimulus to fatigue ratio that we talked about, it's just very hard to be objective. It's almost impossible because you don't know what rep is one rep, you don't know how much lean is, you know, in one rep, and that's the problem.
I think I might have an answer for this problem. I've been thinking about it lately. That maybe for those really technical exercises in calisthenics, for those intense exercises, skill exercises, maybe it would be better to, first of all, progress more by sets rather than by reps, and always trying to have like
same at form, least,
and same form, and at least two reps in reserve, so the form doesn't break down.
Okay.
And you don't grind, and you can be sure that you're keeping a good technique, and maybe trying to add sets instead of adding reps, instead of going to failure. That's one thing. And I also think that many exercises in calisthenics may be better in the lower rep ranges, just like in hypertrophy training. There are exercises that are better suited for 5 to 10 reps or for 10 to 20 reps, right? I think we should start thinking calisthenics in this way, which exercises are best suited for the certain rep range. Right. And I think a lot of exercises in calisthenics may be the best to use in the 1 to 5 reps, to really focus on technique and to really do them right, and to be able to work in the higher intensities, in the harder joint angles, and just doing more sets and not going to failure. Maybe that's the answer to this problem. But when you want to do higher reps and build muscle and raw strength, then maybe it's better to use more general exercises. And when you are in the strength phase, when you are more specific, then doing calisthenics exercises in the lower reps. Of course, there are some calisthenics exercises that will be fine for the higher reps.
Yeah, like push ups, for example, right? It's a good idea, especially with those sets. You know, we can just increase sets and keep the relative intensity the same of those sets. That's a very good idea. And the issue that we come, you know, that we face is that over like the reps, as the reps go by, as the set goes by, there are many factors that can kill your technique and perception of you know, how many reps you can do. If you do 3 reps in the exercise, it's much easier, you know, to because you have, the only factor is your strength. And if you do, for example, 15 reps, there are going to be, you know, many muscles that can fatigue before, that can start interfering with the sets, and that you're going to then compensate by using older muscles in a way that is not productive for this skill. So this is maybe potentially, you know, one way to do that. However, like you mentioned, there are exercises that can be used in the higher rep ranges. For example, those that you do right now, you do, for example, those wide push-ups, right? I really like this exercise, and I recently even started doing, you know, like normal push-ups, either with plate on my back or not. I'm a person that, because of this high specificity that we discussed before, I've been really, you know, neglecting things like normal push-up, because I thought it's not at my level at this point. You know, I have to go into pseudo-planche push-ups. I always have to add some element of, you know, planche into it. but I just, you know, overlooked the fact that normal push-up can bring a lot of benefits. So what are the other examples like of the exercises that you do right now in your phase, in your hypertrophy phase?
I don't have many calisthenics exercises right now, but it might change in the next mesocycle. But when it comes to calisthenics exercises that are good for higher reps, then of course push-ups, deficit push-ups, ring push-ups may be not the best idea because of the stability. The stabilizing muscle will be a limiting factor, so maybe doing them for 20 reps is not the best idea. Stuff like pull-ups, chin-ups are generally better, I think, in the 5 to 10 rep range, but maybe you can go to 15 or 20. Of course, rows, bodyweight rows are great for higher reps. Dips are great for higher reps. Generally, any stable basic exercise that doesn't require that much body awareness. Then you can just go and rep out, and you know that the target muscle is a limiting factor, not some stabilizer, not some lack of body awareness, lack of technique.
So the, for example, low wall handstand push-ups are one of those exercises?
Yeah, back to wall handstand push-ups I think are great in a 5 to 10 rep range also, because you just can focus on going up and down, repping them, and not really, you don't really have to think that much about the technique, it's not really that complicated. And you can also do some more isolation type exercises, I like bodyweight tricep extensions. I think that they can be great. Even though you have to keep your core pretty stable, I think it's not that much of a deal, and you just doing them for high reps at the end of a session, I think those can be great too.
Yeah, yeah. And for example, some core exercises or things like, you know, leg raises or ab rollers on knees or stuff like that. Do you, because I remember you did your ab roller at some point. Did you stop completely?
Yeah, I stopped completely. And with ab roller, we have this problem that doing it on the knees, it's pretty easy, pretty fast, and you can go even to 20 reps, and I think it's fine exercise for low reps or high reps. But when you want to do them, when you want to do rollout on your feet, then it's probably the best to use a ramp, right? Just go on an incline and slowly go down. But I don't have a ramp, so I tried to do partial range of motion and worked not that bad, but I didn't really achieve the full rollout of a proper form.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so honestly, there is only one question on my list that is left, and it's not related to calisthenics this time, or maybe not strictly related to calisthenics. So over the last months, I've seen you, getting deeper into a mobility, or should I say flexibility, world, and that was something that took my interest as well. Basically, there is the term mobility that flows around, you know, in different communities. Pretty much one of the most popular words, I think, in the whole fitness genre. I think that many people, there are many benefits for different people about, like, thanks to this word, because it it's very fancy. It, you know, it can mean many different things, but there comes question like, what does it mean? And I wanted to ask you, do you even use the term mobility at this point? And if so, what does the mobility term means?
So I used the term mobility in the past, and I stopped now completely because I learned more about the terminology, the science of flexibility, mostly from the Dan Van Zandt. He have an account on the Instagram, flexibility that research, and he was the main reason that I changed my opinion. Now I only use the term flexibility because according to the literature, the science, the proper terminology, what we do when we when most people say mobility is really a flexibility training, dynamic flexibility training mostly, or static active flexibility. And as far as I understand, the term mobility really describe the joint, what happens at the joint level, what are the capabilities of the joint. And it's not really the best way to describe what we do when we say mobility, because some people just keep it very simple and say that flexibility is passive range of motion. It's what your body is currently capable of doing when it comes to going to the ranges, just passively. And the mobility, they say that it's strength plus flexibility. Right, so you have strength in those ranges, and it could be that simple, but I think it's not that simple, even though some respected people use this explanation. Like I saw that at Renaissance periodization, yeah. Mike Iratel is explained it like this, right?
That yeah, I heard that.
Strength
as well.
Plus flexibility, but we have to keep in mind that he's not really that interested in the flexibility training.
He's not really into it.
He's not an expert in this particular field.
Yeah,
he's not really going deep into the research and the terminology and stuff like that. So I would rather learn from someone who is obsessed with flexibility, who is the expert, like Dan Van Zandt, and I trust him that the term mobility is not the best term to use, and I would rather use the term flexibility.
Yeah.
From now on.
So if we have flexibility, what types of flexibility there are?
Yeah, he basically explained that there are four types of flexibility. Static passive flexibility, which we talked about before, just doing passive splits and relaxing in it, for example. Static active flexibility, so it can be a split buff, but you tense the muscles, you do isometric contraction, for example, or you lift your leg up and you hold it there. Mm-hmm. That's static active. Then you have dynamic. Dynamic can be passive and active too. So dynamic passive is when you lay on the table and the other person is pushing you into some ranges, right? You just don't contract your muscles. Someone is helping you to get into those deep ranges. And dynamic active is like when you do basically any strength exercise, like you can do lunges and it's dynamic active flexibility. You can do arm swings, right? Stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Hopefully, if I was, you know, if I edited this video out, you got some pictures right here how each flexibility type of training looks like. With your training right now, could you mention once again, because do you still do some flexibility or not right now?
I experiment with static passive flexibility only, so I do it almost every day. Recently it's 3 sets of 1 minute of static passive side split, and I just want to see how far can I go with it without doing anything more intense, because I know it's not the best way to gain flexibility, because the best way would be to combine dynamic active with static passive with static active, right? Mm-hmm. So you do at least once or twice a week hard stretching session when you contract the muscles, and you also do some passive flexibility maybe every day, maybe at the end of your hard flexibility session. That would be probably the best way, the fastest way to gain flexibility. I know, because I did it before, but maybe not in the best way, but now I have a little bit more knowledge. But I want to do only static passive flexibility, first of all, to really to I don't want too much interference with my strength training right now, with my hypertrophy block. And I never really worked that hard on static passive flexibility. I was always more focused on the active. So I want to see if I can improve this area and how it will improve my active flexibility too. Because you have to have some kind of passive base to get better and active. It's not like you can only do active flexibility forever. It's probably the best to combine both, right?
Yeah. All right. So, is there something that you would like to add? You know, some topic that you would like to discuss, or you know, add up to the topics that we already discussed?
Yeah, I think we skipped a little bit the body composition stuff, but I have a post about it on my Instagram. When you go to my Instagram and you see this shitless flexing photo in the mirror, then below it in the caption you can read about body composition for calisthenics. And I just wanted to add that, in my opinion, losing weight is really helpful if you want to be better at calisthenics. And of course you want to lose mostly fat, but I think even if you lose some muscle, it's probably not that big of a deal, because you're still gonna get good benefits for relative strength, because you probably will lose mostly fat and some muscle, and you can always gain this muscle back pretty quickly, because gaining muscle back it's not that hard once you build it once. But I think you will have still more benefit by losing weight, even if you lose your muscles.
Yeah, okay. So we're definitely gonna, you know, link down Jakub's Instagram in the description. Also, you get your YouTube, right? Where you can find our podcast that we did a month ago, I think, or a bit before. On YouTube, do you still post, you know, consistently?
Not really consistently, but I
what
will.
What we can find on your YouTube? What can we find on the Instagram and what on the YouTube? Like, do you split your content somehow regarding the information?
I am mostly active on the Instagram. I post my trainings in stories, and maybe I will start posting them as a post so they don't disappear after 24 hours. And I have some advice on the Instagram, some examples of the exercises, some quick tips and stuff like that. And on my YouTube, I don't have that much videos, because I deleted a lot of them because I was not happy with the quality or the information that I provide, because I always learning and changing my opinions. But I have some, I don't know if you can call them tutorials, tips, maybe. Some old tricking videos, and recently I posted the basic chin-ups and dips variations that I think are good to use in your training. And
okay,
I will post a compilation of my whole first mesocycle of this high volume fat loss phase after I finish it.
Yeah, so I guess we're gonna wait for that. Thank you, Jakub, for you know, once again, for the discussion. It was a pleasure. I myself learned a lot, and I hope that the viewers did find something for them as well, and I'm sure they did. And I hope that we can, you know, repeat like the discussion. You know, maybe we will get some more, you know, knowledge, and in the future we can share that on some podcast of this type. So once again, Jakub, thank you, and
thank you.
See you next time.
Thanks.